This is going to be depressing, right? If you are not already depressed, then you've come to the wrong spot. Just to talk a little bit about what we do, my name is Josh Nieder. I'm a senior fellow with Government Affairs Institute. We are a nonprofit, nonpartisan organization that is dedicated to educating federal workers about Congress and its operation. The processes, how places are funded, for example, how they're not funded, how do we get shutdowns for stuff like that. This is what we do for a living. We were originally created in 1965 by legislation. We were part of OPM back then. But in 1995, when Al Gore was reinventing several things like the government and internet and federal whatnots, he reinvented us out of government, but we landed at Georgetown and our mission basically remains the same. And that is to provide federal workers a more sophisticated understanding about how agencies are authorized and funded. That's our core mission. We have a variety of different classes that we teach on Capitol Hill. People come up to Capitol Hill, they have a four-day class in congressional operations or a two-day advanced course in budget appropriations process or legislative process, whatever it is. We cater our needs, your needs, so that we can deliver the best message and the best information that you need as federal workers to understand what is happening at them. Because oftentimes, nobody knows what's happening, which is the current moment. We'll talk a little bit about that, but I come here to sort of provide a political, review of what's happened, where we are, where we recently were, where we're going to be, and basically give you a sense of what Congress looks like for the next year, what it has looked like. Just to rewind real quick, what was going on in the 115th Congress. This is an unusual Congress, and that is divided government, unified government. Republicans had the presidency, the House, and the Senate. And normally under these circumstances, you would find a lot of activity going on. Congress is going to pass a lot of bills. They're going to make a huge landmark statement on the policy vision of the United States. That's not exactly what happened in the 115th Congress. They passed one major piece of legislation, arguably two, criminal justice reform. For the most part, it was an unusually inactive unified Congress, or unified government. One of the big reasons for that is you had this kind of stark division between Republicans in the Congress and the President of the United States. Right? Now let's remember that President Trump was previously not a Republican before he became a Republican, to run as a Republican and then win as a Republican. And he came with a lot of different policy views that were not exactly orthodox conservative decisions. Right? So during the campaign trail, he was for Medicare for All, and all the Republicans like that is not what he mean by that. He was for all of these large government spending programs. He wanted to do a $1 trillion infrastructure spending program, for example. A lot of these things were not Republican orthodoxy. Republicans in Congress are not like jazzed about passing a $1 trillion infrastructure bill, which is why it didn't get passed. They were not jazzed about a lot of things that they were promoting. So there was this big divide between the administration and Congress to a large degree. And while many people like to say like, this is Trump's Republican Party and this is the Trump Congress, what I think you find is that a little bit more nuanced understanding of what happened would reveal a lot more tension than it would be unification. For example, if you consider things that Congress did this year, none of them were truly President Trump priorities. When the president ran for office, he ran on things like the Muslim ban, that began the travel ban at the very beginning of the Congress, where he was banning people from the country. He ran on an infrastructure package. He ran on the border wall, which is significant today. None of those things happened. Those truly Trump priorities that he ran on in the 2016 election did not really go through the legislative process in Congress. The two things that Congress did do that did push in 2017 were the thing that they've been talking about for 8 years. Right? Does everybody remember what that was? Obamacare, right? As soon as Obamacare had been signed, Republicans were promising to repeal it almost immediately. They tried that. They didn't get it done. But that was their first legislative push. That was their big legislative initiative. We're going to repeal the thing that Democrats did in 2010. That preceded President Trump's run for the presidency. It preceded him in office. It preceded him everywhere. Basically, this has been a Republican priority for a very, very long time. The president taking the mantle and winning office did not necessarily change. Another thing that Republicans are big into was tax cuts. They wanted to reform the tax code. Anybody remembers who Paul Ryan is? He has been running his entire life to reform the tax code, right? So he's Speaker of the House. You all of a sudden have this unified Congress. And in December of 2017, they passed a tax cut, right, which is some combination of corporate taxes and individual taxes and several other capital gains types taxes. Basically, this is another Republican, standard Republican issue. They've been running on tax cuts since the 90s, or that even. It's not necessarily something that the president brought in and changed the party on. Now, the places where the president did try to change the party on is basically how we got here. I'm going to hold off on that just a little bit to talk about what happened in 2018. Now, we just had an election, right? Does anybody know how historic this election was? Yeah, very, very historic, right? This is the largest Democratic majority since 1974, right? The largest incoming class. It is the largest turnout in a midterm election since 1914. Yeah. So about 50-some-odd percent of the American public came out to vote. That's 14 to 16% higher than the average midterm. Now, midterm elections are typically pretty bad elections for presidents. They're often defined as, we don't like what he just did for the last 2 years, and so we're going to punish him at the polls. And this happened routinely throughout American history. So for example, if you look at every single midterm since the Civil War, you'll only find three instances where the president's party gained seats in the House of Representatives. It is historically very unusual. So right from the get-go, you're talking about a electoral environment that's going to be very hostile to the president just because the president's party loses seats in Congress. It just happens, right? We saw that in the House. Democrats regained the House majority. They won a ton of suburban districts. They won all the Clinton districts, but they also won some like Trump territory as well. Places like Northern Virginia. Anybody guess that somebody was going to win in Oklahoma, you would have taken a lot of money from several people, right? Nobody was expecting a Democrat to win in Oklahoma, but they did. Oklahoma 5 is now, this district that Oklahoma City occupies is now occupied by Democrats. So we saw that in the House. You saw this huge, massive incoming Democratic majority. You saw them win 8.6%, or by 8.6% of the popular vote. That is a historic margin as well, right? It's the largest margin since the fourth World War I, I believe. Basically, you saw a major, major reaction in the House. Now, in the Senate, you saw something different. In the House, Democrats picked up 40 seats. And in the Senate, they lost 3. Now, this is really unusual. If you see a wave election like you see in the House of Representatives, where a party is winning 40 seats, you typically see it wash up in the Senate to some degree, right? They've gained 1, or it's a tie, or they've gained 6, right? It's something along those lines. But the reality was that the Senate map this year was heavily biased against Democrats. In fact, there were 10 Democratic senators that were defending their seats in states that the president carried. So senators like Joe Manchin in West Virginia, he's a Democrat in a very, very, very red state. John Tester is a Democrat from Montana, very, very red state as well. You had other senators like Tammy Baldwin in Michigan. You had senators like Bob Casey in Pennsylvania, Bill Nelson in Florida. They're defending areas and territory that the president had won just 2 years earlier. And what makes this unusual is that you had a wave election in the House and then you had Republicans pick up seats in the Senate. That's partly due to the map, right? But even by those standards, what you're seeing is a little bit more than just the standard partisan breakdown, right? You're seeing states that were traditionally Republican, right, become a little bit more a Trump-style Republican, right? Places like Tennessee, right, where Lamar Alexander and Bob Corker were the senators, right? Bob Corker was one of the president's most ardent critics in the Senate. Now, he lost, and he's being replaced by Marsha Blackburn, who is very much a more President Trump-friendly senator. Tennessee got more red, is what I'm trying to describe. Places like Missouri got more red. Places like Indiana got more red. So we're seeing sort of a shift in the geography of these two parties as well. Democrats were able to pick up a couple different seats that they weren't necessarily anticipating. They won seats, they unseated Dean Heller in Nevada. Right? That's not traditionally seen as a totally Democratic stronghold, but nonetheless it was a pickup. And they won in Arizona, where the last time I believe they had a Democratic senator was 1965. Very, very, very. This is Barry Goldwater. Who was to the right of the right of the right at that point in time. So you're seeing some demographic changes occur, right, in those two places in particular. So we have this new Congress that's come in, and we're back in divided government. Now, what does divided government mean? Well, typically means that the president holds one party and the Congress is of another, right? That's actually not completely what we're in. We're in a divided Congress, which is actually worse than a divided government. Here's why. When you have divided government, you have a president who typically has one policy position, Congress, who has another policy position, and they can negotiate where the middle is. Right? Congress passes a bill, the president says no to that bill, and they say, all right, well, where's the middle ground? And they can sort something out. Now, a divided Congress is different because you have the House of one party and the Senate of another party. What this often means is that the two chambers of Congress can't agree on anything, which means that the Congress doesn't actually say anything for about 2 years, right? Because they can't agree. Does anybody remember like the fantastic Congress of 2013, 2014? What happened then? We had a government shutdown. How fantastic is that? Really weird. What I'm trying to say is that these are historically dysfunctional Congresses, mainly because Congress is unable to agree with itself. And then therefore, they have nothing to bring to the President of the United States to negotiate with. So Congress doesn't have a position, the President doesn't have a position, and we're just basically stuck in gridlock. And this is what we're going to find a lot of over the next couple of years. It is not going to be fined by legislative accomplishment. In fact, the 113th Congress, the one I mentioned, was the second least productive Congress since the Civil War. The only one that was more unproductive was the 112th, which was also the bad. So it gives you a sense of how bad these Congresses typically are when you're talking about legislative productivity. Are you going to get a reauthorization this year? Odds are against that, right? Are you going to get a timely appropriation? Hell no. Are you going to get a budget deal, right? Are you going to get a budget deal? Maybe, hopefully before September, right? And definitely, hopefully after they pass a CR. This is the type of politics that are going to be occurring over the next couple of years. It's going to be very, very dicey and much more uncertain for federal agencies. Unfortunately, I wish I could say the government shutdown is going to end in a week and then we're going to reopen government and things will go back to normal. It will not happen that way. This Congress is going to be very, very upset with itself. The Senate is going to hate the House is going to hate the Senate, and the President will be somewhere, and the Congress will have to negotiate with him. We have a lot of big decisions coming down the pike, but the standard line here is that these two chambers can't agree on anything, which means that the government will have a much more difficult time getting to a final decision, because Congress is sort of wrapped up in decision. Does that make sense to everybody? So we're kind of stuck here. Now, what does the 116th Congress look like? Well, it will be historic for a variety of different reasons that may or may not unfold over the next year. But I want to talk about the leadership a little bit in these two chambers. So let's start in the Senate because it's the more boring of the two institutions, in my opinion. We still have the Republicans have picked up two seats in the Senate. They now have a majority of 53. Democrats are working with a minority of 47. Now, the thing in the Senate that is definitive of the Senate and makes it unique within the legislative and legislative realm and world is that it has a 60-vote threshold. Is anybody familiar with the filibuster?
Yeah.
It still exists, right? I know a lot of people think that it may be going out the window. That's probably true, but it's not going to happen this time. The filibuster may die in 5 or 10 years, but it still currently exists, which means that any major decision that the Senate is going to have to make is not going to be done with a majority of 51. That's all you need to pass a bill in the Senate. That's all the Constitution requires. It's just 51 senators to agree with something. But because of a filibuster, you need 60 senators to stop talking about the thing you want to agree to before you can get to that 51 vote. Which means that on any given day, Mitch McConnell is wandering around the Capitol grounds looking for 7 Democrats to agree with him on something. And that can be somewhat easy, right? There's some low-hanging fruit out there. For example, the senators that we mentioned before. Joe Manchin is a very conservative Democrat because he's from West Virginia, right? There are no Democrats there anymore. They're gone, right? You have John Tester from Montana, right? You've got, you no longer have Claire McCaskill, right? You have to go to Bob Casey in Pennsylvania. The problem is after you start getting out of those first 3-4 senators from these very, very red states, you start getting into much more liberal territory. So for example, Sherrod Brown is from a swing state of Ohio. Is Donald Trump going to be able to rely on Sherrod Brown to agree with him on anything? No. Sherrod Brown is super liberal, and he is absolutely not going to compromise. Mitch McConnell's not going to be able to get people like Tammy Baldwin or Debbie Stabenow from Michigan or Wisconsin. Problem is that it just gets very, very difficult to find 7 Democrats who agree with something. The further you go into the Democratic caucus, the more liberal it becomes. So the 7th most liberal Democrat is somebody who's probably not from all that swing. They probably have a very dark blue constituency, and they are probably getting all of the political cues they need to oppose everything that the president says simply because the president said it. The president may say, like, we love puppies, and their constituents are probably like, all right, we're against puppies now. Right? That's the kind of political incentives that they're reaching for. We want an infrastructure package. Their constituents are like, not for him, though. This is the reality of the politics now, is that we're looking at very, very deeply entrenched parties at the moment. And getting 7 Democrats to agree with 53 Republicans is going to be very, very difficult for Mitch McConnell. It's going to make the Senate's life very difficult. It means that you're going to be spending a lot of time looking at the Senate, and maybe not looking at the Senate, confirm judges and nominees. That may be its only utility. Moving over to the House, we have a new majority, which means we have a lot of new stuff coming in, right? We have 36 new women, first time in history, largest female class ever. For the first time ever in American history, 100 women were elected to the House of Representatives, right? 35 are Democrats, 1 is Republican. So we're still working on party equality there. But nonetheless, historic majority in that respect. We also have the second speaker, who is a female, right? Nancy Pelosi regains the gavel of the House of Representatives. She's only the 6th person in U.S. history to regain the gavel after losing it. It is not a common thing, and it is a tribute to her leadership and tactics and political acumen that she's able to retake the gavel for a second time. And again, this is a very, very interesting dynamic because Nancy Pelosi has been leader of the Democrats. Does anybody know how long? Nancy Pelosi's first year? 2002. She is going into her 17th and 18th year on top of the Democratic Party. That is a historic run as well. It rivals only Sam Rayburn from Texas, who was Speaker and or Minority Leader between 1940 and 1950. So she's been there for a good long time. Now, with this long tenure also means that she's more aged, for lack of a better word, as is the entire Democratic leadership. One of the big, big pushes, one of the big struggles that this leadership had is that they've been up there too long, right? In fact, Nancy Pelosi has been up there for 17 and 18 years, right? Who has been her number 2 the entire time? Steny Hoyer from Maryland, right? And who has been the number 3 almost that entire time? Jim Clyburn from South Carolina, right? Their average age is 79. The new incoming freshman class, average age is 45. So to say that there's a generational divide in the Democratic caucus is a literal statement, right? A literal statement, which is why Mrs. Tlaib, who had some controversial curse words for the President of the United States recently, clashed a little bit more harshly with Nancy Pelosi, who was like, well, there's a generational preference there, right? It's like literally she's saying that, like actually, right? And this was a big problem for Mrs. Pelosi because Democrats are getting very, very tired of not having opportunities to raise the ladder. Congress is a very, very ambitious place. And members who are not leaders want to be leaders. And for a very long time, because Nancy Pelosi, Steny Hoyer, and James Clyburn have been unwilling to relinquish their spots, means that it has created a logjam down in the Democratic Party. That is, a lot of young members have not had the opportunity to lead the caucus. There's not been that generational shift. And there hasn't really been like a grooming process for them to come up either. In fact, you saw a lot of the most promising potential leaders leave the House of Representatives entirely. So Mr. Vic Fazio from a while back, he wanted to be a leader. He was pushed aside. Javier Becerra from California, he couldn't break into the bowl. So what did he do? He left Congress and went to become the Attorney General for California. Chris Van Hollen was seen as an up-and-coming leader, but he couldn't break through the top 3. So where did he go? The Senate. I mean, literally, they're just leaving because there's no more opportunities for them to rise up through the ranks. And we saw this come to a head at the beginning of this Congress. Nancy Pelosi had a leadership struggle on her hands. Because when you become Speaker, there's a different threshold. It's no longer like you just have to get a majority of Democrats or a majority of Republicans to lead your party. You need a majority of the House of Representatives, right, which is 218 votes. So we're no longer talking about, oh, you need 130 votes to become Speaker. You need 218. So you've got to get a lot more people in line. So as soon as the election was over, Nancy Pelosi started courting a lot of the various factions within the Democratic Party. Met with the progressives. They walked out of that thing. The progressives were like, oh, we love her a lot. So they're on board, right? And then she met with a lot of the other people. Then we had this Nancy Pelosi, anti-Nancy Pelosi letter. You remember this? This was spearheaded by Seth Moulton from Massachusetts. Seth Moulton did not have very much success in the incoming Congress because he's upset the most powerful woman in the entire Congress. But he spearheaded an anti-Pelosi letter that said, we will deny you 218 votes on the House floor unless you basically come over to our demands, right? Start meeting somebody. Now, Pelosi savvily, started picking these people off one by one. Like, what do you want? Well, I want a bill. Like, done. What's next, right? What do you want? I want a subcommittee. Sure. What's next, right? She just started picking them off one by one and slowly eroded the coalition that was going to deny her a floor majority. And so what ended up happening is that last week we had the speakership election. She won with 220 votes. She's very happy about this. Democrats are fine with it because even though Nancy Pelosi is seen as sort of like the epiphany of the, or not the epiphany, but the personification of the Democratic logjam, they still recognize her leadership and talents. Nancy Pelosi is by far the best vote counter on Capitol Hill. That's not even a contest. I know reporters who have been around for 30 years. They're like, yeah, nobody's even close to her when it comes to the ability to count votes. And that's what matters as a speaker. Speakers are policy oriented, but they're much more politically oriented. The ability to know when you're on board and when you're not on board and when you're being fuzzy in the wrong kind of way. Right? Like, oh, well, maybe I can support that. It's like, she knows when that's a no and when it's a yes. That's her ability to grab a toss as a speaker. Mitch McConnell is a very, very savvy legislative tactician as well. So how these two titans of legislative process duel it out over the next Congress is going to be interesting because it's going to be a lot less about policy making and a lot more about the political message that these two institutions want to create. Now, we have landed ourselves in a bit of a government shutdown. Right? For those of you who are not shut down, 5 appropriations bills were passed. Everybody was super, super optimistic at the beginning of this year because they passed 5 appropriations bills before the October 1 deadline, the September 30 deadline. In other words, Congress had been more productive on appropriations than it had been in about a decade, right, as of September. And we're talking about the appropriations process is sort of working right now. And then here we are, right? As always, Congress will always fail you, so here we are. we had 5 bills pass, right? Everybody was looking rosy and optimistic. 7 bills did not, which means that the majority of federal government agencies are not funded, even though a majority of the funds that fund the federal government are. Does that make sense? The largest bills are out there. About 85-90% of all discretionary spending has been funded. Defense, HHS, VA, all of these are appropriated bills. They are massively big spending bills, which means that most of the discretionary money is out the window. But most of the agencies are not in those 5 appropriations bills, which means that more people are further. Now, why we are furloughed is an interesting story in and of itself, because there was this talk about the border wall and whether or not we're going to have $1.3 or $1.6 billion in funding and whether Democrats were going to accede to that. There had been a negotiation. There had been an agreement in Congress that it was going to be $1.6 billion. It's actually written into the current Homeland Security Appropriations Funding Bill. There's $1.6 billion out there for the president for a wall-type structure. I don't know the exact wording, but it's a wall-type structure. Fencing or something along those lines. There's money out there. And so come into December, right, we're negotiating these things, we're still at a stalemate. What ends up happening is that the week culminating in December 21st, CR expired, we had a deal. The Democrats came out and said, we're not going to filibuster a CR. The majority leader came out and said, we're going to pass a continuing resolution to keep the government open into the next Congress. They'll figure out those issues in the new Congress. Everything seemed fine until Thursday. And then Thursday, the president changed his position, saying that this is not enough wall funding, and I want $5 billion in wall funding. Now, this has ramifications that are broader than simply a government shutdown, because it speaks to some of the dynamics and relationships that make these things different. Mitch McConnell had already passed a bill unanimously in the Senate and sent it over to the House when the president changed his position. Now, what this means is that Mitch McConnell went out on a ledge for the president, passed the CR for him, and then decided he was going to veto it after he passed it. Now, imagine what this would mean if somebody's like, yeah, go ahead and do that thing, and you do it, and they're like, oh, you shouldn't have done that, and now you don't have money. It's not a great relationship builder. If you have looked at the dynamics between Mitch McConnell and Donald Trump right now, this is a leader that is scorned right now. Right? He is on fire at the moment, and he cannot... It does not like being around the president. Like, perfect example, the president had a Rose Garden speech a few days ago, who was conspicuously missing from that Rose Garden speech, having been at the White House at the moment that it was occurring, Mitch McConnell, who decided to take a ride back to the Capitol building rather than stand out here with the President of the United States with the House members. If you have noticed, the President or Vice President Pence and some of his advisors went up to Capitol Hill to negotiate the shutdown a couple days ago. No GOP or Democratic lawmakers were there. So the Vice President of the United States is meeting with staffers on Capitol Hill at the moment. That means somebody's real angry. His name's Mitch McConnell. He is not happy at all with how this unfolded. And if you hear him talk right now, he said, we're not going to bring a bill forward until the President says he's going to sign it. He's put it on his table, essentially. If you find something that you'll sign, and I'll pass it through the Senate, is essentially his position. Similarly, John Cornyn, who is the outgoing majority whip in the Senate, he said something very interesting. He said the next deal is going to have to be negotiated by Nancy Pelosi and Chuck Schumer, the President of the United States. Now, that's a stunning, stunning statement, because congressional majorities do not give up their seat at the negotiating table easily. They do not simply say, like, oh, yeah, no, like, my minority counterpart will spearhead negotiations on this. That's not something that ever happens, right? It's not a thing, really. I'm sure it's happened in the past. I can't think of a single instance when majority leaders of Congress have decided to not negotiate. They always want to be a part of the deal. That's the point of having a majority in Congress, is to be in the room when you're making those deals. But that's not what's going on right now. And it's indicative of the type of relationship between congressional Republicans and the President of the United States right now. A very contentious relationship has only gotten worse over the last 2 years. And there are a lot of Republicans on Capitol Hill who are very wary of following the President where he wants to go. Because this is not a good look right now, right? Polling is against the President right now. We're about to have January 11th come on, which is going to be the first missed paycheck of the shutdown, and you guys can correct me if I'm wrong about that, but it is going to get dramatically worse from here on out. And as the pain starts to ratchet up, and as agencies are no longer able to cope, right, as the parks get more and more, national parks get more and more ugly, right, and they're dipping into user fees, everybody's doing all of these extraordinary measures, the government simply cannot fund without appropriations. And it will not last years, so I can guarantee you that. Right? I hope it doesn't last another month, but I don't know when it ends, unfortunately, because we are in a different style of politics. It used to be that we would sit around, and everybody would have a position that would get them to yes. This is Joe Biden's famous statement. What do you need to do to get to yes? What can I give you that'll enable you to say yes to the deal? What do you want? Unfortunately, what's happened is that politics nowadays is not defined by what we are for, but what we are against. There is this big, big trend that is being uncovered by political scientists in American politics that is called negative partisanship. And this is the notion that you don't necessarily like your own party, but you really do hate the other one. And you hate it worse than you actually like yours. So in other words, this is like saying, I don't like Democrats, but good Lord, have you seen Republicans, right? Or vice versa, like, I don't like Republicans, but have you seen the Democrats? Holy cow, right? And they are more willing to act and send political cues to politicians that correspond with that negative feeling, that negative partisanship. And unfortunately, this type of like tribal politics has been proliferating for a while, but it's really coming to a head now, where people are more apt to say no to everything than they are to say yes to everything. And so what this means is that we're no longer talking about what you need to get to yes at the moment. What we're talking about is who can say no the longest, where the political pressure gets so unbearable that they have to stop. That's where we are currently in American politics. It's not about getting something, necessarily. It's about denying the other side. This is why Nancy Pelosi is so dug in on $5 billion in the border wall. How much is $5 billion of a $1.4 trillion budget? Very tiny, right? And in fact, earlier in January and February, Democrats were willing to give the President $25 billion for a border wall if they would give them Dreamers protections, and the protections for deferred action on child arrivals. Now, they're really dug in on 5%, or $5 billion. Why? Because this is the new game. Same thing on the presidential side. He's really dug in on $5 billion. Why? Because he didn't get all those other things earlier in the year. So now we're at an impasse for a much smaller sum of money over a symbolic thing that ultimately may or may not get built. This is all politics. And unfortunately, there's no obvious answer to how they get to yes. My colleague said when they shut down the government in December 21, like, I don't know how we get out of this. And I was like, you're overreacting. It's going to be fine. Here we are, right? It's still shut down, and we're still in a place where it doesn't look like negotiations have gotten very far over the last 2 weeks. So unfortunately, that is where we are currently. I want to open it up for questions, because otherwise I will just suck all the energy and the air right out of the room and you guys will be suffocating. So if anybody has any questions about American politics, generally speaking, the dynamics of Congress, feel free to ask any.
Yes, sir.
Here's a question I'm going to apologize in advance for it, and if you don't know the answer, that's fine, but if anybody would, I would think would be you. Where are we going to be in 12 months?
In 12 months?
Yes.
Well, unfortunately, I'm pretty pessimistic about 12 months from now, right? I actually can't say with any real specificity, because there are a there are some giant elephants in the room, both figuratively and literally. The Mueller investigation is going to define this Congress. We don't know when that report is going to come out. We don't know what it's going to include. We have some ideas about stuff, but every time we hear something, it turns out that he's like 4 months into the future, so where he is right now, nobody really knows. But that will define what the House does, because the House right now is doing its very, very best not to try to look over enthusiastic about impeachment. Right? They don't want to see it. You don't want to see it as a power grab. If you try to move impeachment or something along those lines too quickly, it will backfire, and it may actually keep the person you're trying to impeach in place. This is sort of like turning on the dance music. Somebody going like level 10 when everybody's like, all right, start at 5, right? And he's like, and then because he's at level 10, nobody's going out to the dance floor, you know what I'm saying? That's a bad analogy, but it sort of captures what we're doing. Public opinion needs to be on the Democrats' side before they can move. And I think a big mover of that will be the Mueller report and how congressional Republicans react. So that aside, I can't predict what's going to happen on that side, whether they do or do not try to impeach the president. There's certainly no shortage of stuff that they could go after. The question is whether or not it's politically palatable. It's something that both parties can get behind. In 12 months, we will also hopefully have negotiated a new budget deal. I know many of you hate the word sequester, right? And sequestration and the Budget Control Act, but the reality is, it's a new Congress, so we have to negotiate another 2-year budget agreement to raise the caps. Otherwise, you guys are going to be living again under those sequestration level caps. Now, the bad news is that you guys got really big, cushy budget increases for the last 2 years. $165 billion over the cap levels. $85 billion for defense, $68 billion for non-defense agencies. Those are huge numbers. Depending on your agency, you could be seeing multiple billion dollars in cuts to agency programs if there is no budget deal in place. So even if we have a CR, you will be seeing a massive cut from the previous year appropriation because that CR cannot violate the BCA cap. So they will need to pass another budget agreement, which will require Nancy Pelosi, Mitch McConnell, and President Trump to come up with a budget that everybody can agree on, sign, and then put into place. At that point, then the appropriations committees can go and write their bills. So hopefully that is done. What major legislative accomplishments will have happened? Probably none. I don't think that anybody, even an infrastructure package, has much of a palette coming through. The Senate will be processing a lot of judges. At the appellate levels, but really what this Congress could be defined by is oversight and messaging, political messaging. So you're going to see them pass a lot of bills that will never come along, and that will be 116 Congress.
Is there precedent, Josh, for negativity being stronger than positivity about one's own party, and what happened in that historic situation?
Now, I can't speak about this partisan-wise, right? So I don't know, because all the studies that we have about this stuff are current, right? They're literally like, this is what's happening now. And we have the means and methodological sophistication to really understand it. We have been this partisan in previous years, right? In previous generations and eras. For example, the Gilded Age, the 1880s, 1890s, 1910s, extremely partisan congresses, right? They would argue about what that chair is. I mean, it was just, everything was very, very, very partisan. The Civil War was obviously fairly partisan, right? And in fact, the negativity thing has always sort of been around, right? But what's new is that this negativity thing and this group sort of tribal politics is more aligned with our partisan identities now than they have been in the past decades. Right? So here's an example. There was a study done in the 1940s where a researcher, a psychologist, wanted to understand when sort of social identity started to affect decision. Right? So his idea was like, I'll bring in a bunch of people to estimate how many dots are on a wall, right? And then I'll label them something. Right? We'll start with something totally innocuous, like labeling, numbering how many dots are on a wall, And then I'll get more and more sophisticated to see how identities affect politics or affect your decision making. So for example, he started off with dots on a wall, and he was going to eventually get to like things that are really, really about people's core identity. Where you're from, your ethnicity, your gender, like things like who you are. And he was expecting like a lot of effects on those like ethnicity, gender, location, geographic identities. But he wasn't expecting like dots on a wall to have a significant effect on decision making. But what did he find? Dots on a wall will affect your decisions, absolutely. So he would have people come in and sit down in a chair, and there would be dots on a wall, and they would say, estimate how many dots are on that wall. And they would give a number, and he would randomly say, oh, well, you're an overestimator, or, oh, well, you're an underestimator. And even with that little cue, that innocuous little cue about how many, guessing how many dots are on a wall, what they found is that it dramatically affected the decisions that people made. So what would end up happening is he would say, okay, well, you can give the overestimators $3, and you can have $5, or you can have $2 and the overestimators can have none. Guess what we decided there most of the time? Yes, right? They were more willing to give the other side, overestimators or underestimators, nothing than to give themselves more. So that was in the 40s, right? So it's always been around. But what's happened is that these political identities are much more interwoven with who we see ourselves as a person now. And that means that we're making a lot more political decisions based on this sort of like identity. So it's always been around. It hasn't been correlated with partisan identities as much as it has been now. But in previous eras, I would imagine it was probably there too. Yes, sir.
What's your prediction in terms of how this whole debacle is going to influence or affect people's interest in careers in civil service? Like, do you expect folk to be like, heck with it, I'll just stick with private industry?
Which debacle are you referring to specifically? Is this the shutdown debacle?
Well, that, and I guess ever since, you know, the past couple of years has just been a hot mess. But yeah. This in particular.
Yeah. No, absolutely. I mean, you hit it on the head, right? This cannot be good for recruiting. If you want to bring in the best agents and the best people into your agency, this cannot help. It's only going to hurt. Like, hey, why don't you come into the federal government where you might have, well, you'll have less appropriations than you really need to fund your programs, and every once in a while you have to go on furlough. It sounds good, right? It's just not a good line. It's not a fantastic line, I'm not going to lie. But this is something that we've seen generally across the federal government. It's not just a decline in trust. It's a decline in trust in all institutions of government, right? Whether that's Congress, the executive branch, or the judicial branch. There's been declining trust in our governing institutions. Congress. There used to be like really, really serious legislators in Congress. Right? They're gone now. They've retired. They all leave. And every time that they leave, they say the same thing. You can't get anything done. So what do you do as a legislator of Congress? Well, you put out a lot of press releases. Right? You have to go through all these horrible events. You work 6 days a week, like 90, 80-hour week, work weeks. And then you get to pass almost no legislation. It's not great. So it absolutely has a dramatic effect on federal government recruitment, attraction of talent, retaining that talent. We see that at the congressional staff level too. We have a lot of very seasoned staffers who are like, well, this place is terrible. See it. And they go and make much more money in the private sector. That's a challenge that is government-wide. Right? And I don't know that it's going to change any time in the near future, but I hope it does. Right? I hope we get to something a little bit more routine. And one of my big hopes is that since the BCA is going to be sunset at the end of next fiscal year, hopefully we'll get to a more routine budgeting process, which hopefully we get to a more routine appropriations process, and at least we're not shutting down the government every 2 years. Hopefully, right? But again, this counts. Yes, ma'am.
I could be wrong. I've been furloughed for 4 minutes, so I've just been watching all kinds of news. With the president indicating that there will be no cost of living. Do you foresee that being more than a year?
More cost of living increase?
Yeah, he said there would not be a cost of living.
Well, that's interesting because Congress has a different opinion about that, right? In their bill, there is a 1.9% bump in salaries in their appropriation bills. This is another big thing that there's a huge disagreement between what the administration wants and what Congress is willing to give. And government salaries is one of those things. So I do think that there will be increases now that Democrats have gavels in the House. I think that there will be more increases than we've seen over the last 6 years in particular. But Will there continue to be a struggle? Yes. Right? Will that struggle put downward pressure on increases in salaries and stuff like that? It probably will. But I think what you'll see is a little bit more routine of the increase of COLA, increases in salaries. Because Congress, despite what the administration has said, has been less willing to go along with those sorts of agreements than what the administration commissions. They've been more willing to buck him with those types of issues. Yes, in the back.
I have no intention of being funny, but I have two questions, and none of them are mine. Serious. I was away for vacation. I live in the area, but I was away on vacation, far away from here. And people think since I live here, I know everything like you. And anyways, there are two questions people ask me, and I didn't have an answer. So if I may ask, one question is, I was asked your interpretation of prominent Congress people who are now running for office. That's one question. The second one is, there are countries where they have dictatorships and repression and everything else. They still look up to America as the beacon of hope and democracy. So those people are still optimistic. So if you can maybe, you know, look further, you know, what are things that other countries with dictatorship look forward to in America? What are still the good things you see despite everything you said? So those are
thank you. You're a ray of sunshine, please. All right, so in terms of prominent politicians wanting to become president of the United States, like everybody in the Democratic Senate wants to do that, right? There are a lot of people running for president right now. Everybody's like, oh, well, they haven't officially declared. They're running at the moment. They're doing all of the steps that you would need to do. They're writing books. They're visiting Iowa for no particular reason, right? They are running for president as we speak, and that currently consists of at least 24 people, right? At least, like, more than which come from the Senate, more than half of which come from the Senate. So Ben Sasse, Republican from Nebraska, he may challenge him. Jeff Flake has not said that he won't do it. Beto O'Rourke, who lost a Senate seat, thinking like, hey, maybe this presidency thing is for me. You have Amy Klobuchar from Minnesota. You've got Kamala Harris from California. I mean, Sherrod Brown from Ohio. You have Jay Inslee from Washington. I mean, it's insane. It's absolutely insane, right? So the good news is that people do still see some hope left. The politics is nasty. It's more difficult to get things done, but you are finding much more mobilization for good quality candidates to run for these offices than we have in the past, particularly the last 2 years. Right? Democrats had more quality candidates than they had in a generation. That's one of the reasons that they did so well. So we are in a very weird spot in our politics, and I can't say that it's good. Right? There's just no way to do that. There are norms that are breaking down. There are things that you just don't say that are being said. People are questioning election results. These are not good trends. But what I can say is that this government is not built for efficiency, like a dictatorship is, for example. Right? In a dictatorship, you can make a choice, and that choice becomes law. Here, it is the opposite. It is not an efficient form of government that we have, the House and the Senate and the President. The separation of powers makes things extremely difficult. It makes our confrontations very difficult. It makes them numerous. But it also makes us one of the more strong, institutionally robust democracies in the entire world. And the fact that we are able to resist many, many efforts to sort of take over these dictatorial actions or words or statements or whatever you want to say, the fact that American democracy has withstood those statements over the test of time is a testament to exactly how durable our institutions are. In a different political system, we would have a different process. We would have a different result. For example, if Donald Trump was prime minister of England, England would look very, very, very we have a separated powers of system, which means that the United States law looks pretty similar as it did 2 years ago, despite all the efforts and changes. And that is because you have to compromise in the system, you have to create consensus around multiple different constituencies, and that makes us very good. And it makes us very robust as a democracy. Not everybody shares that, everybody wants quick action. I'm like, nah, man, this is an anti-tyranny machine. Yes, ma'am.
Question. Wouldn't the constituents have some power to kind of really put the pressure on their individual congressmen or women to speed this up? I mean, the impact of the government shutdown just doesn't affect the government. It's a rippling effect. So I would think the pressure of wanting to be reelected in 2 more years and also in 4 more years with some of the other positions, wouldn't that kind of put the pressure on them to say, hey, I'm getting a lot of calls from my constituents. We need to make a decision.
Right.
Would that influence some type of
decision? Absolutely. You're starting.
I'm hoping it would.
No, yeah, and you should keep calling, right? For sure. Say a different name, too. you call them multiple times. Because, like, when you're in a congressional office, you're getting hundreds of calls a day, right? And everybody's got, like, Bob, right? Bob calls, like, 40 times a day, and right? So it's like, Bob, what's on your mind now? He's like, I'm going to the store, and I've got this thought. And then so, like, okay, right? And they will hand that to a staffer who will sit there and just listen to Bob for an hour, right? Bob doesn't have the greatest sway, but if you have your friends calling and stuff like that, right, you're not allowed to go lobby on behalf of the federal government, right? It does, constituents do have an impact on the way people think, and you're already starting to see that. Democrats are passing a lot of bills right now to reopen the government, a lot of different bills. They're going to be doing this week. They're going to pass four different bills to reopen government. They're going to pass the appropriations bills, and then they're going to challenge the Senate and the President not to pass them and not to sign them. You're already starting to see defections on the Republican side for these sorts of things. And as they continue to pass these bills, and as you can see, Democratic defections rack up. The number that you're really looking for is 290 in the House and 67 in the Senate. Right? Once you have that, you have a filibuster-proof majority, a veto-proof majority in the House and the Senate. That means that the President can veto these bills, but if he does, it's subject to an override by Congress. In other words, Congress will reopen the government over the President's objection. To your second point, why hasn't there been more pressure? It's like we're sort of just on the cusp of where it starts to get very painful. So for example, like home loans, right? You need VA, you need FHA, you need a lot of agencies. The agriculture, IRS has to verify incomes. You need a lot of agencies' help when you're trying to buy a house, right? Banks need it, mortgage lenders need it. They need all that help. Now, a lot of the people that were buying houses in December are already through that system and it hasn't started to affect that market. But as soon as you start to see that market start to trickle into it, it's like, oh no, the IRS can't verify income, or no, you can't get that loan from this particular ag or whatever it may be, or no, FHA can't help you right now. You're going to start to see the economic pain ratchet up. And unfortunately, that means economic pain for many of the people in this room. It's not good, but it's going to create a lot more pressure as these downstream effects start to affect everyday constituencies. And that will only make the shutdown more and more painful as we go, which is exactly why it's not going to be here. So I hope it will not be here. Yes, sir.
So one thing, my brother and I were talking about how much power a president has, whoever's in there, and it appears they have more than they should. It looks like Congress should be our body that should do this. But when Trump said, and maybe tonight or this afternoon, whenever he's going to do his speech, he made what we were talking about, bring out the national emergency and say, the wall is that, I'm going to get my money and have the military build it. Does the president have this power or not? I hear both sides.
Yes. They can declare a national emergency, and there are a variety of enacted laws that give him the ability to take over industries, for example, or move money around, military around. It's a profound authority that has been given to him from a variety of different authorization bills over the span of several decades. Now, Congress can also stop these things from a variety of different ways, right? They can verbally say, don't do that, or we'll punish you. Or they can legally say that, we'll pass a bill that will prohibit you from doing this, or we will take those powers away if need be. So that's going to be really, really interesting to watch tonight. Are they seriously considering a national emergency? Because that is a serious, serious thing to do. It's done in wartime.
Yeah.
Like, that's been it. 9/11, that's been it. It would be a major, major, major breach of governing decorum, if you will, to do that. And the question is, how does Congress respond? That is anybody's guess. I know how the House will respond. But the Senate does will be fascinating. It'll be fascinating to watch the Senate. All right. I think I need to go, because Trina said I have till 1:15. I may have to go. I can do
but
one more.
Nobody's working, so
I could probably do one more question. One more question, then we'll wrap up.
Isn't there a time or a point at which the message about the shutdown is just going to be old news and people are just going to tune out? I mean, it seems like the politicals are playing to the cameras right now, and at some point, it's not going to serve them.
Right.
Well, what's the time lag on that?
Well, they're going to continue to go to the cameras because there's a great political scientist named Shah Scott Snyder, who said, when you're watching the game of politics, pay attention to the crowd, because the crowd is often excessive. How this plays out in public opinion, how this plays out messaging-wise, is going to determine who wins the shutdown and who loses the shutdown. So they're going to continue to go to the cameras. Now, what kind of marginal increase are they going to get on every single media hit that they get? Well, it's probably going to go down. But nonetheless, they need to win that message, because that's literally all it's about, right? Literally all it's about is that message. Why you are keeping the government shut down and enforcing this thing because of what credit is. So pay attention to the public approval polls that come out right now. It's going to give them a sense of who's winning and losing. It's going to give you a sense of who's going to come out and maybe win. Hopefully soon. But I'm a little bit more optimistic that that will play a significant role in how this government is real. Unfortunately, like, you'll just have to see more. Anyway, thank you guys for having me. I'll hang out for a while.